Moin, welcome to the channel Tech and Ice. Now, I've been using this Samsung Galaxy S23 Ultra for the past 6 months, and wow, what an amazing phone this is. So, if that's all you want to know, then yes, this is an absolutely outstanding phone. But if you want to know why I think that is, then please stick around for the rest of the video. Let's get started. The sides of the phone are made of aluminium, and I love the fact that they are also matte and not glossy like the stainless steel material on my iPhone 14 Pro. The back of the phone is made of this frosted matte glass, which hides fingerprints exceptionally, and it also has Gorilla Glass Victus 2, which should make the phone able to withstand drops even better than last year's S22 Ultra. It feels good in the hand, even though this boxy design makes the phone pretty wide and the corners stick a bit into my hands. I got this gorgeous red color that's sold exclusively on Samsung's own website, along with some other nice colors. I went with this color since I haven't had a red phone since I think the iPhone SE 2020 model. And I really, really love that phone's color. I also got it with 12 gigabytes of RAM and 512 gigabytes of storage. I've currently used around half of the storage already. Now, I will say that it's good Samsung decided to go with 256 gigabytes of storage for the base model this year, since the system alone uses almost 60 gigabytes of storage. I would not have been able to survive with only 256 gigs of storage, let alone 128 gigs of storage. And I imagine most people buying this phone are power users who need a lot of storage. The phone is also equipped with 5 cameras on the back, a 12 megapixel ultrawide camera, 200 megapixel wide camera, 10 megapixel telephoto camera, and another 10 megapixel telephoto camera. I quite like this island-like design of the camera's lenses instead of the usual camera bumps we see in a lot of other smartphones like the iPhones. I think it makes the phone seem much more sleek and elegant, and it also enables it to almost lay completely flat on the surface. Now, on the front, you see this massive 6.8 inches 1440p dynamic AMOLED screen with a variable refresh rate of up to 120 Hz and all the way down to 1 Hz, which should help prolong the battery life. This screen is amazing. Now, I got it set to vibrant mode, since I love when the colors pop on the screen. But it's cool to know that I can just go into the settings and change it if I ever wanted it to look more natural. Due to the size of the screen though, it's almost impossible for me to one-hand this phone without some serious finger gymnastics. Luckily, Samsung has a few tricks up its sleeves to solve this problem. I can, for instance, minimize the screen by swiping down here on the bottom, which I often use when I need to reach the top corners of the phone. Samsung's keyboard also supports one-handed mode, so I can text with one hand. I just wish I would be able to switch to this in the middle of writing a text message instead of having to decide before I start texting. Samsung also had this one-hand operation plus setting, which enables me to short swipe up and down on the screen to get access to stuff like the quick panel without having to reach one of the upper corners of the phone. You are also able to swipe back in an app from both sides of the phone, so it doesn't matter what hand you are holding the phone in. Through an app called GoodLock, you can also customize this even further. You can also disable the swipe gestures and just use button navigation, just like in the good old days. The screen is plenty bright and has a peak brightness of 1750 nits, which is a tad lower than the iPhone 14 Pro series that has 2000 nits. Though in a day-to-day, I don't really notice the difference, and the phone gets plenty bright, so I'm able to see everything no matter the weather I'm outside in. The phone also has a few features to adjust the screen brightness, like this extra bright mode or extra low mode, depending on your needs. It also has this so-called eye comfort shield, which should limit blue light and use warmer colors so it is easier on the eyes. You can then choose whether the feature should be adaptive, so it automatically adjusts the screen colors depending on what time of day it is. Or if you want to, you can just adjust it manually. You can also make the screen go as dim as possible and black and white, which I find very useful in the late nights or early mornings, so I don't blind myself. I've set up a routine, so it automatically does this when it's time to go to bed. The screen's got curved edges, which I feel a bit ambivalent about. On one hand, I love it, since it still makes the phone look more premium and futuristic compared to phones with flat screens, and it makes everything more immersive when watching videos or playing games. On the other hand, it also makes it a lot more difficult to buy and apply a screen protector on it, and it also makes the phone feel much more fragile if you ever drop it. Thankfully, I haven't experienced any accidental touches due to the curved edges on the screen when I'm navigating the phone. Samsung has also reduced the curved screens a bit from last year's S22 Ultra, so it is a bit flatter than last year, but all in all, the phone's appearances are very similar, so it would almost be impossible for a normal person to tell them apart just by looking at the build. Some may say that Samsung has dropped the ball when it comes to innovation, and others that if it ain't broke, don't fix it. I don't really mind, since I think this design overall is amazing, and I much prefer a company to keep the same design for a few years and keep refining the phones instead of having them to come up with a completely different design every year. This would also make the phones seem more bland, and people wouldn't be able to recognize a specific phone brand from afar if its design changed each year. The S23 Ultra also has an always-on display. This is one of my favorite types of always-on displays, as it is subtle, yet I'm able to see small things like a photo or animation and the battery percentage. So it is useful, but not distracting. I love that Samsung offers a plethora of always-on displays, fonts, through their theme store, and it's a joy taking your time to really play around with it. And of course, some of them cost a bit of money, but there's also a lot of free options, which I really like. On the right side of the phone, you'll find the volume button and the on-off switch, while there isn't a single button on the left side of the phone. The placement and clickiness of the buttons are quite good, but I would have loved to see something like the alert slider of the OnePlus phones or even iPhones to be able to quickly juggle between silent, vibrate and ring mode of the phone. On the bottom, we see some speaker grills and the S Pen slot. I think the speakers on the S23 have improved a lot compared to the S22 Ultra. Take a listen for yourself. Måske jeg burde have en plan. Jeg tager det dag for dag. Nej, ved ikke hvad jeg laver. Der er folk der bygger rumraketter. For dem er livet ikke meget lettere. Jeg var et mirakel for den dag. I'm no audiophile, but I do think that the S23 Ultra sounds more crisp, and I don't really have to turn up the volume as much as I had to on my S22 Ultra. Now let's compare the S23 Ultra to my iPhone 14 Pro. Måske jeg burde have en plan. Jeg tager det dag for dag. Nej, ved ikke hvad jeg laver. Der er folk der bygger rumraketter. For dem er livet ikke meget lettere. Jeg har lige lært at gå på hænder. Måske jeg burde have en plan. Jeg tager det dag for dag. Nej, ved ikke hvad jeg laver. Der er folk der bygger rumraketter. For dem er livet ikke meget lettere. Jeg har lige lært at gå på hænder. In this case, I think the iPhone 14 Pro sounds better. It gets louder and I'm able to hear more details of the music playing than on the S23 Ultra. The S Pen is one of the most underrated features of this phone. I love the fact that it just lives inside the phone, so I'm able to access it quickly wherever I am. I use it to jot down a few notes while at work, write a grocery list, sign documents, and occasionally I'll even use it to relax and do a bit of coloring through Samsung's coloring app. The latency of this S Pen is only 2.8 milliseconds, which is insane. Especially if you think about that Apple's Pencil Gen 2 has a latency of 9 milliseconds. This S Pen is super responsive and is the closest thing to writing on paper that I've ever tried. It also makes this nice sound when writing, which only adds to the immersion. This can of course be turned off if you, for whatever reason, don't like the sound. It also really came in handy when my family and I went to France on vacation, as I was able to transcribe written text in French to Danish. It worked so well that we understood what had been written well enough to, for example, order the right food. You can also just use the pen to navigate the phone like you would with your finger, and it's super responsive. It is also able to control the volume when watching videos on YouTube or Netflix. If you click this button, you are able to pause and stop the video. Press and hold triggers the camera, and guess what? You can also control the camera with the S Pen using swipe gestures to switch between the camera modes, front-facing camera or the back cameras, and clicking the button can take a photo or start and stop a video recording. You can also make some live messages with the pen that you can send to your friends and family. Smart Select is a feature that lets you copy a specific part of the screen easily and then write or draw on it to maybe create a GIF or something. Now, these are just some of the things you can use this S Pen for. It's such a neat feature to have. And no, I do not think it's a gimmick, it's definitely a feature. But I gotta admit that I don't really use the S Pen on the daily, but it's good to know that it is there inside the phone whenever I need it or want to use it. The phone has one of the most versatile camera systems out there. It's got plenty of different camera modes, such as food mode, portrait mode, and panorama. It also has an ultra-wide lens, 3x optical zoom, and a whopping 10x optical zoom. And it can even zoom up to 100x digital. Now, this isn't new compared to last year's model, but I still believe this is the best phone when it comes to zoom. I often use both the 3x and 10x zoom when taking photos of my kids having a cute moment or the wildlife in the woods or maybe at the zoo. The 100x zoom is mostly used for fun, such as being able to take a picture of a sign without needing to walk up close to it, or moon pictures, or a bird in the distance. I don't really fiddle with the pro mode of the camera, but it is nice to see for those photo experts out there. I mostly just use the standard 12 megapixel camera, as I like how these photos often turn out bright and contrasty. I sometimes use the 200 megapixel to capture footage of a nice scenery, but often find the colors to be a bit dull and the photos to be a bit washed out. But I'm seriously impressed with how much detail the 200 megapixel photos have when zooming in on them compared to the normal 12 megapixel lenses. Samsung also spent a lot of time during the launch event to speak about nightography. I think it takes decent photos in low light, so I don't really have any complaints there, even though the colors sometimes are a bit off. For example, the light from a street light often appears more green than yellow. I really like the portrait mode on the camera and how good it manages to keep the subject clear and in frame, all the while it's blurring out the background. The video recording on the S23 Ultra is also really good. I mostly record at 4K 60, but it can go all the way up to 8K 30 frames per second. Most people say that it isn't as good as the iPhone 14 Pro, but if I'm being honest with you, I don't really notice any differences, especially in good lighting. It also has this so-called super steady mode, which rivals the iPhone's action mode. It's pretty fun to use when you're running or walking in a very bumpy area. So overall, I think this camera just make capturing moments fun, and it makes me want to pull out my S23 Ultra and use it, as I know it'll produce some very, very good pictures. Now, the cameras are not all pure love though. Samsung still struggles with motion blur. This is especially annoying if you have kids or pets, as both kids and pets rarely stay still for too long, especially when you try to capture a photo of them. Couple this with Samsung's shutter lag, and I often end up missing some key moments with the kids when they are running around and having fun. This is very disappointing, and I really hope that Samsung would have fixed this with this year's S23 Ultra, but sadly, they haven't been able to do that just yet. I may prefer the colors produced with the S23 Ultra, but often I take pictures of my kids when they are running around using my iPhone 14 Pro, because it's still just able to capture it more clearly than the S23, sadly. Another reason I often end up using my iPhone to take pictures of the kids is because it's so difficult to share images between Android phones and Apple's iPhones. And well, both of my parents, for instance, they have iPhones. So whenever I have taken a cute photo of the kids and I want to send it to my parents through the SMS or messages app, then it just turns out so small and pixelated when they're watching it on their phones. And also, if my mom sends me a picture of something, it also looks so small and pixelated. And I do know that this isn't really Samsung's fault. It's mostly Apple's fault, since they refuse to adopt the RCS messaging that Android phones are using, and they just want people to get iPhones so they can be a part of the iMessage system. Now, in Denmark, where I'm living, this iMessage system isn't as normal or widespread as I know it is over in the US. So mostly when I'm not texting my parents, I can just send the photos to my friends through Facebook Messenger, and then it's just fine. But for my parents who refuse to use other social media apps, it's just difficult to share the photos. Now, I also have Google Photos, so sometimes I have tried to send a picture through a link to my Google Photos so they could go and download the photo in good quality on their phones. But I'm actually not sure if my parents dare to open the link. So yeah, that's still a problem I haven't been able to solve with the Android Apple thing. This also makes it very difficult to escape the Apple's walled garden, but that's a topic for another video. Now, the UI of Samsung has really come a long way since the TouchWiz days. Before, I always thought that the Samsung phones were a bit buggy and laggy, but with One UI 5 and the new Snapdragon 8 Gen 2 inside this, I haven't really experienced that many bugs or stutters, and this is one of the smoothest phones I've ever used. I'd even say that I've experienced less bugs on this compared to my iPhone 14 Pro. I do, however, still see some micro stutters, but nothing major. Overall, the phone is fluid and fast, and I love how you can customize everything. For example, you can even customize the animation speed. I've got mine set to 1.5x, so it seems even faster than usual. But you can also just set it to 1x or even 10x to make it go as slow as you want. Multitasking and customization are the two keywords I would use to describe the UI of Samsung's phones. You can use split screen like on most other Android phones, but you can also enable this pop-up feature and have multiple small windows of apps on top of each other and so much more. Using the Edge panel over here, you can quickly access apps or action controls. And you can even customize which apps you want in here, in what order the different Edge panels are, and so on. Samsung even has a whole store for the Edge panels. You can also customize your home screen to your liking with widgets. And you can place your apps anywhere you want. And even dive into the Galaxy Theme Store, which can change everything from the app icons to the background, Samsung keyboard, and the colors of the quick panel. In the settings, you can also enable how the phone notifies you when you get a notification with these edge lighting styles, and so on. Most of the widgets are also interactable, so you're able to play and pause a song in Spotify without having to go into the app itself. And if you put in the time and effort, you can really make this phone your own. But if you don't want to do that, you can also just use the phone how it is out of the box, and it'll be just fine. It's the options that matters, and I really, really enjoy having the options to do whatever I want with my phone and make it look however I want it to look without it being too difficult to access that possibility. The S23 Ultra also supports Samsung DeX. This turns your phone into a mini laptop whenever you have a monitor to hook it up to. Now, it still runs Android apps and not full desktop apps, but for writing a document or browsing the internet, this works fine. It's amazing to think that this phone could actually serve as some people's personal computer as well. To keep this phone going strong, Samsung equipped it with 5000 milliamp battery. The battery life on this phone is super good in general. On most days, I end my day with around 30% battery life left and a screen on time of around 3 to 5 hours. I've only had it die on me once during my day in the life video, where I used it heavily for video recording, taking photos and navigation with Google Maps, which all drains the phone faster than just scrolling through social media. It also has this feature called reverse wireless charging, where I'm able to charge up my AirPods through the phone, which is pretty cool. It supports up to 45 watts fast charging and a 10 watt wireless charging. I think this is just fine since I can get it fully charged in around an hour or so. But if you look at the competition, Samsung is definitely falling behind, since there are other companies like OnePlus who supports 100 plus watts fast charging and they charge up their phones in less than 30 minutes. So yeah, thanks for watching this video. If you stuck around to the end, I really appreciate it, and it's been really fun making this video. And yeah, I just wish you a very nice day or night depending on when you're watching this. Bye!